Brains are from 2015. Even before that, he was the brains behind the success of the Shuka. And before Chiwanuka and company took over, it is game on. Another fine day, fine edition of what we should be expecting today. We have so much lineup on the local and on the international scene. Of course, the third quarter final tie, first leg between Bugeba and Chambogo will be happening in about 30 minutes or so for a place in the semi-finals. UPL football, a stunner of some sort when Maroons FC of Douglas Bamwana came out to Magopa Stora United. And in the Euro 2020s, it was 4 for Ronaldo and 5 for Portugal, who maintained their unbeaten run in the Euros 2020 qualifiers. Nicholas Novotrou is my name, and of course, joined by Brian Asimwe and Fred Mugerwa. Welcome to the show, Fred, again.
Thank you.
Pleasure to have you. We had you during the Netball World Cup. We saw what happened, the faults. You advised accordingly, and it was quite, you know, the honors to have you at the time. And I feel like even then, there was still so much to discuss. We shall tap into netball for a while, but for now, it's all about handball and what you achieve. Before we come to you, Brian Asimwe, good afternoon. You're looking all quiet and very, very, should I say, demoralized about something that could have transpired in your life? Or am I reading the wrong way?
Like, you might be reading the wrong way, but nonetheless, I have lots to be super grateful for. Lawyer Snare is very excited to be back here for the show. In the intro there, I spoke about a couple of things, and one of the things that stood out for me was Cristiano Ronaldo, the kind of night he had last night, drawing his tally of international goals now to what, about 91, and he's closing in on the all-time record for the, you know, the most number of goals scored for during an international career. So it's interesting to see players, you know, as they get older, they only get better. Mm-hmm. So I think for me, Cristiano is one of those players that has evolved over the years. He certainly continued to grow as his game has also, you know, grown as well. And he's now giving back the national team. So some fantasy stuff there last night.
And it kind of pounds your brain. Age 34, and you're scoring what? You have 93 goals.
Yeah, 93.
There's a bit of you saying, I can actually even make it 100. So that means you're not about to retire, are you?
The all-time record is at 107. It's held by a guy from Iran from way back. That is Issa Dia. And it's at 107. So if you do the math, there's a difference of about 14 goals or so.
So we look at 5 hat-tricks and he's good to go.
Absolutely.
Fred Mugerwa, another fine, fine day of sports, of course. So we always come through, discuss sports, nothing other than sports on our lips. You've lived the story, you've lived the journey. Take us through handball as a sport as we look forward to another independence run. From the 90s, from the 80s, what was that like? Handball, how was it founded? Who was behind it? And for you, as a person who lived the story, what can you tell us about the sport in handball?
Good afternoon, viewers. I mean, those who are viewing us. Handball, I think, in fact, it started in 1971, I think.
1971.
Yeah, and it was introduced by the gentleman called Onegi Piminga Nicholas. This is a gentleman who was a police officer by that time, and he was a swimmer. So I think he got a chance of going to Germany for a swimming course, I think. And while there, when in that college where he was interested in handball. So when he came back with the idea of introducing handball to Uganda, and he started introducing handball to the police during that period of time. And that is how handball started in Uganda. Although he didn't have enough knowledge about it by that time, but he just had an idea.
A rough idea.
And people started playing. But me personally, I joined handball in 1976 because earlier on, I was playing hockey and basketball before. This is a sport that I joined in 1972 while in primary six, they were, while studying at police student school. Because the police ground was so close to us, that's why I say the later Kibwa was just near us there, they would train together from the same ground. So I used to play those games. But again, when handball came in and found out that it was so interesting, unlike basketball, where I was disadvantaged because of the height, and then football with a lot of challenges because there were many footballers. So when handball came in, I said no, let me go for handball because there were still very few people that had come in to join the sport. So that's the time how I joined handball.
All right.
Yeah.
Brian, when you look at, you know, people like Fred, there was a story online saying that when you looked at Fred back in the 70s, or even currently. you don't have a second glance. It's not the same when you have a nice looking woman passing by you. Well, you want to have a one look and then go a second look just to make sure you've actually fit in the right way. But when you look at guys like Fred Mugerwa and the likes of the like Akiba, the one I just mentioned, these are more like the unsung heroes who actually did so much for sport, but they were never recognized on that avenue.
Yeah, I think he's given us an insight before he came on air about how he spent a couple of moments with John Akiboa right before he went for the 1972 Olympics in Munich, and then when he came back. And you know, it's always very saddening when you see people that have gone out there and given to sport in such an outstanding manner, and when they come back, they do not have that much to show for it. They've carried the Ugandan flag quite high, they've represented us on the global scene, and you really feel like at the end of the day, they never get the appreciation that they deserve. But for a coach like Fred Mugerwa, really, he's one of those people I'd call true sportsmen, because he also happens to be very versatile and very diverse, because it's not just about the netball that probably a couple of folks out there know him for, but he talks about handball, obviously he talks about hockey that he's played, he talks about sports like basketball. So you can clearly see that these are guys that had a come up of playing sports, and certainly even after playing the game, he decided, I'm not going to just hang up my boots, but let me give back, and he took on the coaching, which is quite interesting as well. So there should be better done for such people like this.
Mugerwa, you seem like an all-rounder in that regard. I mean, for a kid back in the 70s, you know, back at police children, a primary school in Chibuti, sounds like you're a bright child. But moving forward, when you discover that your interest was going to be in handball and not the other disciplines like hockey or basketball that you did participate in, what was your major drive behind it? And even then, do you feel like handball gave back to you like you gave back to it?
Yes, somehow yes, because in terms of traveling as a coach, because when you take a team out, at least you travel and happen to see some areas that probably you have not seen. During that period of time, I think I learned a lot and I gained a lot, because by training people from nowhere to somewhere, I think that is something that I enjoyed most. And I think that is what I must have, I'd say that I gained through my playing. And that when I left playing and became a coach, I brought people on court, and some of them, in fact, I'm happy to say that the ones still running the federation at the moment, because when you look at the current general secretary, is the person that I trained handball personally.
Patrick Abuel?
No, general secretary of handball federation.
Oh, handball, the NCS.
And then when you look at the treasurer also, is the person also who was in my club, was in the Leroy's, and so many other players that I've been training. So, to me, I think I've given back to the sport.
But has handball given back to you?
Not as much. Because here you just, in the sport like we are in right now, for us is we give in. We don't expect anything.
In return.
We just give in.
Talking about you giving back, a couple of names popped up. Harriet Apako, Beatrice Zawedi, Christine Larubade, Flavia Angwech, Annette Namutebi, Janet Auma, who passed on, may her soul rest in peace. Maliza Mukembo, Sauda Babidie, Noel Nabayaza, Mori Ezalu, Carol Badaru, Rose Kiti, Leticia Namuga, Barnetta, Bernadette, Kiza, and Millie Namakula. All those names pop up, and I'm wondering, these names are from way back, these names pass through your hands, these very names.
From Larry Handball.
Yes, we'll probably sit back and say, this man made us what we were back then. I don't know where the lives are right now, but I would imagine if you're a student and you happen to pass your final exams, you'd want to say thank you to your teacher for a job well done. Is that the case with you?
Yes, some of them, yes.
Some of them, yes.
Some of them, because when you talk about Lubade right now is in the UK. Once in a while, he calls back. And in fact, for me, I don't expect always to tell those people that I've trained to, like, I want money from them. No, just a mere call or a text message to tell me, coach, are you still there? I said, fine, I'm there. Then I feel so proud about that. And, you know, some other people think that whenever they leave, like those who go out, they leave the country, and they think that when they are there, when you want to talk to them, they are thinking that you want money from them, and which is not the case with me.
Well, way back in 1992 with the Uganda Railways handball aside, you dominated locally. According to reports back then, we were born, well, Brian was born as well. But I would imagine that you dominated the scene with so much vegan character. What was the major thrive behind it?
What we did was, when Lero was being started, we started from scratch. So that I gathered players who had never played a game of handball before. Yeah. So I started from the scratch and we were training together. All the names that you read there, mm-hmm. they started almost together at the same time. Mm-hmm. And we grew up. In fact, the first match we played was in Mekono. I remember that match. And we lost to Bank of Uganda, I think, I don't know how many goals. And we only scored one goal at that time, mm-hmm. period of time. So when we came back with the players, we said, now, if we can manage to score a goal during that period of time, and with the training, we can do it. Mm-hmm. And in fact, we did it. And we won the East African Handball Club Championships from 1991 mm-hmm. until 1999, when Lures was disbanded. And the players were, most of them were terminated. Mm-hmm. That's when we lost the trophy. But during that period of time, still in 1995, we went to India and we came back as the Commonwealth champions
at the
ladies. Yeah.
Well, so much dominance in there. Of course, the lines are now open. That is 041-433-7872. You can actually drop us a call and talk to the legend himself, the unsung hero, Fred Mugerwa, from the 70s, the 80s, dominating handball, also giving back to netball in 2015, having the She Cranes participate in what was an exciting outing for the She Cranes in Australia. We saw how that transpired in 2019. He did come out with his expertise and giving a word or two to the girls down in the UK. The number again is 0414-337-872. You can give us a call and give us a reaction in regards to not necessarily handball, but also netball, and speak to the legend in Fred Mugerwa, who has done so much, just like the others, like John Akibwa, the lad who passed on in 1997, becoming the first Ugandan athlete on the track and field to win Uganda its first gold medal in Munich. That was way back in 1972. And right now, he's, of course, laid to rest. And we have so many of these. We shouldn't just necessarily talk about them, but also gratify them, embrace them, as they have done so much for Ugandan sports in general. The number again is 0414-337-872. Have a caller? Good afternoon. Hello, caller. Yes, good afternoon. Your name and where you're calling from?
This is Omong.
Yes, Omong, talk to us. What would you like to comment or ask Mr. Fred Mugerwa?
Actually,
we just lost that one there. Well, step away from your TV set, that way we can actually get clear voice from you. And the number again is 0414-333-4337-872. Hello, caller. Oh, we just lost that one there. Well, Mr. Fred, when you look at this country, I feel like sport has been given attention now at this point in time in that regard, because not like before during your playing days. Maybe less facilitation or even non-facilitation. I would imagine the season has now changed from what it was like back then, from what it is right now.
Yeah, in fact, during that period of time when I started playing, I remember the first time I was so happy when I was included on the team that was traveling to Nairobi, mm-hmm. The police team that was around 72, by being given a track suit that had the writings Uganda behind. Mm-hmm. I was so happy that when I went to wash the track suit, I made sure that the word Uganda is facing the road where everybody can see.
Just a moment. I want to call her. Hello, caller. Oh, I think we just lost that one there. Yes, that excitement from your end.
Yeah, and in fact, it was just because in the police team during that period of time, I was still a student, and we were just given uniforms, just t-shirts to train in, and that was enough.
At the time?
Yeah,
at the time. I would imagine that the mind wasn't really exposed on what you actually deserve to get or what you were entitled to get, because, again, if you're representing a country, that for me is pride all the way. We've seen this happening, we've seen it still happening. And for the 70s and the 80s, going into the 1999s and the 2000s, I think now you had grown into bounds, and it was realistic that you deserve more than just a tracksuit or even a t-shirt.
Yeah. In fact, it started at least giving in something as mm-hmm. allowances whenever you travel, but mm-hmm. it wasn't much.
Mm-hmm.
At times, would you travel, go out, and you are given around $10 for 7 days. You come back with $70
mm-hmm.
only, and when you change, you just buy a few things here and there,
mm-hmm.
and that's exactly what we could get.
Brian, there is a worry here for the athletes, not just for handball, for netball. Sports seems like a short-term career. You're in it for about 5 or 10 years, and then you're out. But then there's always been a worry of financial discipline. Head of State in His Excellency Yoweri Kaguta Museveni was very specific to the Uganda Cranes when they came back from Egypt, that you have got to be your own example in that regard. Spend wisely, because today you have it, tomorrow you don't.
Yeah, I think that is pretty much what happens in most of the sports disciplines. But mm-hmm. There's so much that has happened back then that probably is different from today. Because
mm-hmm.
I think for me, back then, sports wasn't as well received probably as it is today.
Mm-hmm.
Especially for if you look at a sport like football. Because most of the times back then, the Uganda Cranes weren't getting the kind of reception that they get now. When they go out there now and come back, you're seeing all these incentives
mm-hmm.
coming through, especially from government. You'll find that the boys that came back from the AFCON, each of them must have bagged an average of about 200 million. So you can clearly see that sports has now been better received these days. It's now upon the players what kind of lifestyle they choose, what kind of habits they choose, but most importantly, what kind of financial decisions they make when they come back from some of these international tournaments. I think for a night it's easier, especially also given the fact that the person in charge of education and sports
mm-hmm.
happens to be very close to the man at the top. So you have the sense that there is a seat at the table for sports in Uganda in the recent past, which I do not think was necessarily the same case, but for the days when you had Idi Amin, who was always very hands-on with sports. But even then, I don't think the money was coming through as much as it is. And even today,
mm-hmm.
you've got all these corporate bodies that are willing to embrace sports, certainly come through with sponsorship. So there's more money that is being injected
mm-hmm.
in there. But I want to speak a little bit about handball. And what happens is, I think there's been a couple of pleas from a couple of stakeholders that they should have an independent sort of commission that runs the league, because if I'm not mistaken, some of the big clubs are pulled out, including police and prisons. I think our coach here could probably tell us a little bit better on that. And there's also been a couple of, initiatives to make sure that they go the sport.
Mm-hmm.
They've had the Zone 5, where the girls have recently gone and represented us earlier this year,
mm-hmm.
For the boys as well, to pretty much nurture talent. And I think for me, the biggest talent is still coming through from the schools, the primary schools, the high schools, and you've also got to give it up to the higher institutions, specifically
mm-hmm.
in Deje. They've been extremely hands-on with some of these sports.
I guess that's the reason why many of these organizations or private companies want to tap into raw talent, and probably even the federation as well, that runs a handball. Your thoughts on that? He talks about a couple of them withdrawing or standing out or standing away. Is there any truth in that?
Yeah, the only one I had, I read on our page, was about either Evergreen, but I've not found out why it was moved. But on the fixtures I see, I think police is still there.
Mm-hmm.
We are only waiting to see, because the league, the second round is resuming on Saturday.
This Saturday?
Yes, Saturday. So we want to see those who are going to be present, then we shall know exactly who are there.
Well, the number again is 041-4337-872. You can actually call up and speak to Fred Mugera and ask him questions, react to handball from way back in the 70s, if you were born 80s, going into 1999, 2000, straight to where we are this very day, as the sport has seemed to have grown from what it was back then to where it is at this point in time. Mr. Fred, there's been a conversation of funds allocation, whereby certain disciplines don't seem to get a fair share of the cake. Do you believe in prioritizing certain disciplines and deprioritizing other disciplines, or do you believe in equality?
No, to me, I believe in equality, because what football can do, the other sport can do.
Mm-hmm. In terms of delivery.
Yes, because right now when we talk about World Cup, I think netball has gone there 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
Football has never gone there. It has never been there. And other sports, maybe boxing has been there.
Rugby has been
yes.
there.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that there is a need to probably inject in more funds, especially when you look at these other sports of ours.
Mm-hmm.
When I talk especially with the handball, recently they took players out who went for All African Games in Morocco.
Mm-hmm.
To me, I wasn't satisfied with the players. Because
the batch of players that they took?
Because the players themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Because we took secondary school students to tussle out with the ladies
You mean we handball or?
The handball Uganda team. The team was composed of mainly students, secondary schools, student players. Yet the people we are going to face outside there, those who are real women.
Professionals, if I
should
say.
Those who have been there in the handball for a period of time.
I beg to cut you short. In a way, you'd want to think that is early exposure for them. There is no Sutton or even trying to have these young ones go out there and you know, face against some senior top class players.
They have at least the category of, like, when you talk of the youth and the under 19, under 20, those ones can be there. But when it comes to all African games, this is where we don't have age limit. Okay, so every person who's either old and younger can participate, but depending on how experienced you are. Because when you look at teams like Angola, these are real women who normally give those Europeans challenges. And you take our young, small, these small girls of ours who can't play there. To me, I wasn't happy.
Very, very.
And that one, I think, goes back to the federation, because I think they have not done enough to have more clubs on board. Because when you look at the teams that you normally play in the secondary national secondary schools competitions, you find that we have around 40 schools participating. And majority of these people are playing handball. Normally, you find them in higher classes, which means a year or two, they are out of secondary school. They join universities. And universities, they are handball and handball being played. But after universities, what happens?
After that.
After that. There are no clubs, okay, that can take them in so that we have a lot of challenges, I mean, a lot of competition. The few clubs you have are within Kampala, apart from Ndeje and UPDF, which come from the Bombo side. But I expect teams like, because we have so many teams, secondary schools in Mbarara, we should be expecting clubs from Mbarara there to come up. We have teams in the Gulu and so forth. We should be having those clubs there.
I would like to put you in the spotlight, Mr. Fred. Time and again, we tend to single out the diseases that tend to eat up this federation. Administratively, do you think the sport of handball has been failed in a way? Because we tend to also want to blame people that tend to run the federations. They're running them with so much greed, with no expertise, knowledge, with no qualification. They're just in there because of the monies, just to earn a salary on a weekly or a monthly basis. Do you think that also has a contribution to the downfall of handball in this country?
I don't think that they are paid, because this is a voluntary work.
I mean, overall.
Yeah, but what to me, I think we normally, as when we come in as leaders, we don't look at tapping the talent. We only look at the few people that we have at that particular time. But when these people go away, what happens next? Because formerly, we used to have very good players, like the ones you read, those who are from Leres. We used to have players from Bank of Uganda. We used to have players from prisons and so forth. This would form up a very strong national team. But now they are not there. Okay? The few that we have, the clubs that we have nowadays have students coming in. Somebody takes a school, and because the school wants to the players to get that experience, I says, okay, I registered my school to play in the league.
All right. We have a caller. Hello, caller. Oh, we just lost them right there. We'll briefly look into Fred Mugerai's profile before we can actually climax this conversation, the history of handball in Uganda, from what it was to where it is right now. And of course, for Fred Mugerai, he was a player from way back, and he won four league titles at the time, and one in basketball, surprisingly, as he came out during his days in the 70s and the 80s. He played handball and hockey for the national team. Furthermore, he was a handball coach after his playing days. He went on to handle clubs like Kofi, clubs like Uganda Railways, clubs like Police FC, Makerere Divasti, Crescent High, and Bukoyo SS, as well with the women's national team. And furthermore, he went on to win 8 regional titles and 9 league handball titles. He also led the Uganda Railways women's team in the 1995 Commonwealth Club title, to a 1999 Commonwealth Club title at the time. In 2011, he came out and led the national handball women's team to gold, gold medal at the All Africa Games, and he stretched it to the netball Ukraine's team as he was a coach, and he handled the Uganda Railways Police, Old Kampala, St. Peter's, in Sandy SS Crescent High, Mitiana Central College, Chebambe Girls, Kaboyo SS, St. Mary's SS Tutenda, among others. He guided the Ukrainians to 2013 Five Nations Cup, and just recently he also did manage to have the Ukrainians qualify for the 2015 Netball World Cup. Migera is a great B handball and netball coach, plus an umpire. Again, the unsung hero who needs to be given thumbs up for what he has done for the sport of handball and also for the sport in the netball with the Ukrainians. I guess for me, the stats always speak for themselves. For us to judge any sports, any sportsman or woman or athlete, or even then a footballer or a striker, we've got to look at the stats, your achievements. And when you look at this, are you satisfied, man? Could you have done more than what you achieved?
Yeah, I think I would have done better if we had the resources by that time, because there are so many competitions that we could not participate in because of funds, which I think nowadays at times the funds normally at times come in. As I said, if we had, I think I would have done better. With the players that I had.
Brian, describe Fred in just one sentence as we leave this conversation.
I think he's someone that probably has lived life to the fullest, in the sense that he's coming and giving his absolute best to the sport. But then also, quite importantly, we will struggle to find guys from the generation that we've got here that have probably gone through the kind of nurturing that people like this have gone through. Because at most, when you find someone that is a sportsman in the day-to-day, they'll at most be able to play one or two sports, or probably, you know, at most three. But you look at a guy who has played sports, you know, very versatile sports, and it's not your ordinary sports. It's not just the football and the basketball and the rugby, but it's sports that most of the times we probably do not give the platform that they deserve. Because I noticed that at the beginning of the show, he talked about how handball came here, and he was already playing hockey, and he chose to say, listen, you know what, let me go and try out handball. And most of the times, everyone would go like, why should I play handball, really? Because for the longest time, handball has been an understudy to football. You know, people feel like it's a knockoff, you know, to use the pun, in terms of, you know, being related to football. But we should be glad as a country to have people like that that have given to sport. And certainly, hopefully, in the times to come, most of the new kids coming up now can tap into some of the knowledge that people like him bring to sport in Uganda.
Thank you so much, Fred Mugero, for coming through. And it's an honor, just like I said before, it's always an honor to meet people like you, because again, it's because I'm in this job that is why I'm meeting people like yourself. And I hope the country and the entire world can recognize your efforts, not just for hand, but also for netball as well, cutting across the other disciplines. That is Fred Mugera coming out to give us a history of the sporting discipline in handball and what he has achieved, what he helped achieve with the sporting handball for the others that went through his hands. That is in Fred Mugera. Now, 5 minutes exact to be exact ahead of the kickoff. That is in Bugema University facing Chambog in the third quarterfinal, first legged affair down in Bugema. And of course, for the Uganda Golf Open, tee off earlier on this morning, 100 plus million Uganda shillings at stake for the professionals, not just in Uganda but across the region and across the continent. We'll be right back with more of the sporting stories. Don't go nowhere.
Game on. It's game on. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Game on. It's brought to you by...
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.